Penguin Random House Audio presents Read This to Get Smarter, about race, class, gender, disability, and more. This is the author, Blair Imani. To everybody who has ever been made to feel like a nobody. Introduction. Welcome. Thank you for being here. My name is Blair Imani, and I am an author, educator, and historian. I firmly believe that learning is a blessing, and my life is dedicated to learning and helping others learn. First things first, you are already smart. Intelligence is the ability to learn and apply information, and that is something that we all do every day. Even though we are already smart, we can always get smarter about the world, topics we're not deeply familiar with, and the lived experiences of other people. Read This to Get Smarter explores how we can become more informed, compassionate, and intentional as we work to better understand ourselves, others, and the systems around us. Getting smarter is a journey, not a destination, and a great deal of our journey will involve unlearning. Patience, mutual respect, and perseverance are all important tools to carry along the way. It might be frustrating to realize that we will never be done in our learning journeys, but it's also exciting because we can constantly transform our perspectives as more accurate information becomes available. Many of the understandings we have been taught and socialized to believe are based on the assumptions of long-dead European colonizers, who worked to maintain systems of supremacy and dominance instead of presenting fact, evidence, or truth. If we do not prioritize getting smarter, then we deny ourselves the full complexity of the human experience and instead subsist on inadequate and harmful assumptions. It is not my intention to present solutions to the myriad consequences of these assumptions. Instead, I offer a starting place to achieve a shared understanding. Inspired by Smarter in Seconds, my viral 30-second microlearning video series, Read This to Get Smarter utilizes my signature concision to make abstract and theoretical concepts more concrete in a well-researched, well-presented, and accessible manner. I do my best to educate others from a place of humility, and I am honored that you have dedicated a fraction of your time in this life to learn from and with me. Read This to Get Smarter is divided into chapters on identity, relationships, class, disability, race and racism, and sex, gender, and sexual orientation. Starting with ourselves and working outward, my goal with this book is to provide an important foundation of knowledge, ready to be expanded. We will get smarter using information that is strongly supported by the decolonized historical and anthropological record, sociology, and the work of scholars, past and present. This book contains valuable tools such as charts on terminology and corresponding explanations, guidance for interpersonal interactions such as how to apologize, and a comprehensive timeline on the invention of race. Every journey toward getting smarter is different, so feel free to listen to this book in order, skip around, and take notes throughout in as much or as little time as you need. Each chapter concludes with reflection questions to help you apply your new understandings. You can think about them, discuss them with a friend, or journal about them. Our very consciousness means we can get smarter and collectively experience the blessing of learning every single day. Let's get started. Chapter 1. Get Smarter About Identity. Before we begin our journey, let's start with you. Who are you? The answers to that all-important question are what make up our identity. Any discussion of identity can get abstract and philosophical very quickly. In this chapter, we will discuss identity as the combination of personal and social identity. Personal identity is the way a person perceives themselves, while social identity is the way others perceive them. Personal identity relates to the things that make you uniquely you, such as your interests, beliefs, gender identity, and sexual orientation. And while identity formation is in many ways connected to socialization, only we can ultimately define our personal identity. Social identity, because it is dictated by those around us and connects to the concept of social belonging, is often prioritized above personal identity in social situations. While social identity can encompass some or even many parts of our personal identity, it doesn't always, because who we understand ourselves to be does not always match the way others understand us. For example, as a bisexual woman, I am often incorrectly identified by others as a straight woman. The fact that I am sometimes not believed or understood to be bisexual is not because of a personal failure to be bisexual enough, but is due to bi erasure, which makes bisexuality both invisible and disbelieved. Bisexuals are bisexual despite how other people might perceive us, and regardless of whether we are single or in a relationship. In this aspect of identity, my social identity and my personal identity do not always align. Stereotypes, erasure, and oppressive systems mean that many of us are perceived in ways that are fundamentally disconnected from our personal reality. Despite this, our personal identity is still valid, even if it is not honored externally in our social identity. One way to understand identity is as a flower with many petals. Picture your favorite flower and imagine that the components that comprise you, whether they are personal or social identities, are the petals on that flower. I picture myself as a sunflower with many petals that represent my gender identity as a woman, my sexual orientation as bisexual, my religious identity as Muslim, my racialized identity as Black, my national identity as American, the languages I speak as English and Spanish, my relationships, my career fields, and my interests. These petals can shed, grow, and change as we go through life, and we are allowed to have as many or as few as we decide. With this understanding, we can be reassured that few people look at a flower and judge it by how many petals it has. Rather, we accept a flower as a beautiful and unique whole. Whether you're as complex as an orchid or as minimalistic as a tulip, you're a radiant part of the garden of life. Before I started thinking of identity in this way, I considered the petals of who I am to be too numerous and cumbersome. When I listed parts of my identity, I thought I had to trim them down a bit. For example, when I converted to Islam in 2015, I felt that I had to remove one identity label in order to make room for my new religious identity. Society made me feel like my identity was too much, too other, and too different, but that is not true at all. Who we are is real and valid, regardless of whether we are understood by others. Names. As you already know, my name is Blair Imani. You might not know, however, that my parents named me Blair Elizabeth. The name that we are given at birth is usually called our birth name or given name. In some communities, the name that appears on government documents is called a government name. Whether you call this name your birth name, government name, or given name, it may be different from what you go by in the world, and that's okay. Names are often the first or only thing that people know about us. So it makes sense that we should like and feel comfortable with our names. And if we don't, we can change them. That's what I did. At various times in my life, I did not like my birth name. I always liked the name Blair, but I never much cared for Elizabeth. When I was a child, this was because Elizabeth was difficult for me to spell. Once I mastered the spelling, I still didn't like the name, though, because to me, it was a white woman's name. And while ideally names should not be racialized, the fact that they often are is a reality. As time went on, I started to realize that when people read the name Blair Elizabeth, they didn't picture me. The most poignant instance of this was when I was hired for a position at a law firm. I was surprised because they hired me right over the phone. They saw my resume, read my name, and felt that I would be a perfect fit. When I arrived for my first day, on time and ready to go, I sat in the lobby for about 30 minutes. Any time I attempted to make my presence known, I was assured that I would be helped in due time. An adept eavesdropper, I eventually overheard the receptionist asking herself, "Where is this Blair girl?" I politely cleared my throat and said, "Hello." Again, I was assured that she would be right with me. The receptionist finally decided to call the new hire, Blair, to see if she was coming in. My phone rang. I answered the phone while making direct eye contact with the shocked receptionist. The firm had hired someone far more diverse than anticipated. Blair Elizabeth was not, as they had assumed, a white woman, but a Black woman. In fact, I learned then and there that I was the first Black person to be hired in the company's decades-long history. Oops. As part of our personal and social identities, names help to distinguish us from the rest of the world. They can be formally given to us as young people by our caretakers, be given to us as nicknames by other family members or friends, and/or be chosen by ourselves. At the most basic level, names are just collections of letters and their associated sounds. Of course, in practice, it is rarely that simple. Which names and how many we have, as well as their spellings, pronunciations, and cultural associations.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.